In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. You may be seated. Well, this week I drove by a church in our neighborhood that always has an entertaining message on the sign out front. On Monday it read, "Jesus is coming soon, ... hopefully before the election." I like their optimism, but no such luck, huh? So today, to those who are proud and celebrating this week, and to those who are scared and upset this week, God calls us in the scriptures this morning to take a step back, to take a deep breath, and to look away from things that are temporal, from the things in this world that come and go, and to instead look to the things that are eternal, to the things that will last forever. And so today, as we near the very end of the church's year, we turn our focus to the oldest and the one true hope of Christians, as strange and as unfamiliar as it sometimes seems, our hope that Christ will come again in glory to judge us in love and righteousness. And so likewise, we focus on the oldest prayer that Christians have for the thing that we need the most. Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. The disciples today are marveling at the beautiful stones in the Jerusalem temple. They are impressed with what an incredible edifice had been built there in Jerusalem. They're showing off to Jesus the beautiful structure, what human wisdom and power have raised up that will no doubt last forever. They don't know that in a few short years, this building meant to last forever will be burned to the ground by the Romans, leaving nothing but ashes and rubble behind. So there's a tragedy to their excitement today of what they're admiring, like someone taking a tour of the World Trade Center in early September of 2001. And from our own lives, we know that this is true, that the things of the world that we gaze at, the things that seem so solid, the things we're so invested in or scared of, they can all change in a moment. They can all disappear in a moment. Jesus says today, you're impressed by this? You're fixated on something so temporary as this? It will all be thrown down. When? The disciples ask. What should we look for? We ask. Well, Jesus says, if you want to know how to read the signs of the times, if you want to know what is happening, how about this? You will hear of wars and rumors of wars. Nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes and famines and plagues and great signs from heaven. In our nation, perhaps divided this week, in our world that is weary with constant war and terror, as earthquakes shake the innocent across the world, as drought visits us right here at home, we begin to think, uh-oh, this doesn't sound good. This is it. This has got to be the end. But Jesus corrects us. No, he says, no. The end will not follow immediately. But watch out. Many will come saying, now is the time, or I am the one. Well, it's not the time, and don't listen to them. In fact, like the old saying goes, it's always darkest before it's total darkness. Cheer up. Things are going to get a lot worse. Christians will be persecuted and arrested, betrayed by those they love, Jesus says. A pastor from overseas, known to many of you who has preached from this pulpit, I won't be too specific, was kept in a police station for many hours this week, detained for spreading the good news about Jesus, under arrest for arranging surgery for an orphaned child. You'll be kept in a cell all day and all night because of me, Jesus says. But fear not.
fear not. This will give you an opportunity to testify.
In the midst of every kind of danger and disaster and disappointment, Jesus tells us this morning, this is not yet the end. But all these things happening will give us an opportunity to testify. To testify about the God we know in Jesus. The God so loved the world, so loved you, that he gave his only begotten Son, so that everyone who believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. To testify by filling a simple shoebox with some gifts for a needy child you will never meet, but will know that she is loved by a heavenly Father who will never leave or forsake her, all because of you. To testify by bringing in some extra cans of food for the CCA food shelf in town so that if someone who is in our city will not go to bed hungry tonight but will go to sleep with a full belly because of you. To testify, thank you, Brett, by filling out and returning your pledge card, your giving plan, saying that you want to support worship and ministry here in the heart of New Haven, and that everyone here today and everyone who is not yet here deserves to hear good news about Jesus every week. To testify by taking your faith and your hope and your love into your job, into your neighborhood, into your relationships, and to show with your life that there is a light that shines in the darkness this season. We are called this season to testify with our lives, to not be wearied in doing good, as Thessalonians encourages us this morning. I saw another sign this week, a sign that you see on TV and at the train station. If you see something, say something. Today, as Christians, we see something that we have to say. That Christ has died, and Christ is risen, and that Christ will come again. We see that his kingdom has been founded by his death on the cross, by his rising on the third day, and that his kingdom is coming to you in faith as we live lives of faith and hope and love that testify to him. Because Jesus also sees something this morning. He sees you and calls you his own. He sees you and speaks your name. Yes, you may be hated because of my name, Jesus says, but not a hair of your head will perish. He who formed you in the womb, he who saw you as he gazed down from the cross, he promises today that he's got you. He promises to provide for you and protect you and to care for you. He promises that no matter what happens in this world, no matter what happens in your life, you are safe and secure in him. And that though the path may not be easy, though the path will not be easy, he will be with you. And that ultimately, not one hair on your head will be harmed. He whose hair was pulled out by the guards, he whose head was crowned with a crown of thorns, he promises that you will be safe and unharmed, that he will bring you through every danger, every trial, that he will crown you with glory and honor, and not a hair on your head will perish. Jesus is coming. The sign is true. But he is coming not just at the very, very end in glory, but this morning, to you and I who are given a chance now to testify to this world, he comes to us again. We will pray around the altar, come, Lord Jesus. Come, Lord Jesus. And so he will. The Son of Righteousness, with healing in his wings, shines upon us, coming down from heaven, giving himself to you in the simple gifts of bread and wine, in his body and blood and soul and divinity, broken and shed for the healing of your body and soul,
his life poured out in love for the healing of all nations. This week, in your life, all kinds of danger and discord will be out there. But this will give you an opportunity to testify to the one who looks at you and your neighbor in love and promises to be with you always. So do not be weary in doing good, and fear not, not one hair of your head will perish. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.